Mr. Harrison, I have so many questions for you. So let's get into this thing.
All right. Okay.
Wendell Harrison, welcome to Something Came From Baltimore.
Oh, good. Glad to be here. Glad to be communicating with Baltimore. We have a lot of friends in Baltimore. You know, come to mind, Gary Bartz and Tim Shepard. And my wife has a lot of relatives in Baltimore. I used to play the Left Back Jazz Society in the 60s in Baltimore. It's a big, really big organization that brought in entertainment on Monday nights. It was upstairs. I forgot what street it was on. You know, but it was pretty great place. My mind is gone now. You know.
Well, that was my question for you. You're 79, and you're 78 right now, right?
Yeah, October the 1st, I'll be 79.
What do you have any tips for people to stay active and longevity? Do you have any health tips?
Well, just in general, not for me, just in general, the main thing is having a positive outlook on life and like you say, exercise and diet. Like every day, at least three times a week, I go for a walk, long walks, or I go to the gym and deal with the treadmill, you know, get this cardio up, you know, keep my blood going. A little bit of push-ups and pull-ups, little weights, nothing that's really that strenuous, you know, because I'm just really trying to keep my energy going, you know, keep my energy going. Try to stay away from a lot of meat. You know, I used to be a vegetarian back in the 60s. And lately, you know, I started back eating a little meat, but lately I just deal with some chicken, eggs, eat fish, and a lot of salad, vegetables and salad, and fruits and stuff like that, you know.
I'd say that's all good stuff. You do your best thinking when you're walking. Somehow things like go into... click in, and you're like, wait a minute, I feel more clarity.
It's clarity, and it keeps the stress down. A lot of times I go for a walk, I'm thinking about something, thinking about a problem I have to work out, and I'm working out problems, you know?
Sure.
And I analyze stuff, because I'm very analytical anyway, being a musician. You have to be active, you know? Then I come back and try to deal with these instruments I play. Lately, I'm a saxophone player, but lately I've been playing a lot of clarinet, bass clarinet. And you hear that on the CD.
Yeah.
I play a lot of clarinet, bass clarinet on the CD, Get Up Off Your Knees.
The first thing that you said was optimism, and that's what this album is. It's filled with optimistic thoughts. And we're going to get into that. But before that, I just want to get into some questions. Like, I'm looking at your bio. I have questions, and hopefully we can dig into them if you don't mind. I'm going to hit you with some oldie questions. We're going to get into this album. In the late 60s, your Wikipedia said you had 2 years to try to be sober, like a sobriety for 2 years. What took you so long in that time period?
I started in New York, you know, 61, 62. I was working with Grant Green. He used to mess with heroin, you know, but I was clean. I was like a vegetarian and whatnot. The draft, when we had the draft, you know, I was running from the draft. People was trying to get me, to go into the service, you know, and I was on the road a lot with different groups and whatnot. So finally, I went to downtown to register for the draft on Whitehall Street in New York. And they asked me if I used drugs. I said, well, yeah. I was actually using, I was just smoking a little herb, you know, it wasn't really that big a thing.
Uh-huh.
But 2 years later, I was a drug addict. You know, I started using drugs with Hank Crawford, in the Hank Crawford's band, about 21, 22, something in that era. And the guys were saying, man, you can really play if you take a hit off of this dope, you know. I say, so I rejected it for about 6 months, and so we went on the road going from New York to California by the way of the South. You know, it's about the boringest tour I ever had. You know, because it's like in the South, by me being a vegetarian at that time, folks didn't know nothing about fixing a great salad.
You know? No, that was like that was like you were from another planet at the time.
Yeah, right. They would fix greens, but they cooked the greens to death. You know, I mean, it was cook all the nutrition out of the vegetables and whatnot.
Yeah,
you
know? Cabbage had to be fried. Fried in oil.
So I went through a lot of changes playing on the road, going down south, and then they thought we was freedom riders at the time, and I had to. So, like a lot of police would stop us going from, let's say, Alabama to going to Oklahoma or something like that. You know, they thought we was one of the freedom riders. You know,
they're watching your every move.
Protest. Yeah. He was watching you, you know, and they stop you 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, you know. And we have to tell them, we just going to the gig, sir. We just trying to make it get to the gig. You know, we had a lot of crazy experiences on the road. But anyway, long story short, we talk about drugs. So I got to California, and we played in this club. We opened club called the Showcase in Oakland, California. So guys was really trying to you know, influence me to actually use some heroin. So I broke down and said, well, hell, I've been out there about six weeks, and I said, well, it's not gonna really do that much to me. I'm gonna try this. You know, I was very aggressive in those days. I was could try anything. Nothing could hurt me, you know. So I said, well, hell, what the hell, I'll try it. So before we went on the stage, I got high, and I threw up for 3 days. It really felt good. You know, dopamine was flowing, and, you know, I couldn't do no wrong. And they said I was playing some stuff I never played before, you know. So I said, well, no, that was the first time. Then the next week, we're going back to, headed back east, dealing with these same little clubs and concerts in the South. And I said, well, let me try it again. Next week, I tried it again. By the time we got back to New York, I was doping every night. Ooh. You know. Yeah. And didn't know I had a habit, you know. So we stayed in, we was off for 2 weeks, and then we were supposed to go into Small's Paradise for 10 days. And so all of a sudden, I was out of drugs, you know, but I didn't even think of nothing about it. So I got this cold. I thought it was a cold. Then it turned into the flu, you know, and then I was so weak, I couldn't even get out of bed. I was sweating and stuff. And the guys would call and say, are you all right, Wendell? I say, I got a little flu or something. He say, man, you strung out. You need some drugs. And I couldn't believe it. I was really hard-headed, you know. So I stayed. We had 2 weeks off. In the first week, I didn't do nothing but stay in bed, and I was throwing up, and, you know. So finally, the guys came by and said, if you take this, you'll straighten up. So I said, well, let me see if I could do this. So I took some heroin. And man, in about it just took a minute. I was strong as a bull. I was up around dancing and stuff, and I was euphoric, you know. Uh-huh. And telling jokes and all that kind of stuff. But I had to say, I realized this is what this is. Guy said, man, the bass player said, you strung out. Mm-hmm. So it scared me at the time. I said, oh, wow, this is what I was like 22 years old. So I called myself tricking myself. I was going to get enough, and I was going to wean myself off, call myself weaning off the drugs. And every time I would get quantity of drugs, I would do it all up, do it all up at once. I had no discipline, you know.
No weaning.
no discipline at all, you know. You know, and just trying to play tricks on. And then from that point, for 4 years, I was recording for Atlantic with Hank Crawford and different people. I was working, but they noticed that my engagements went down, you know, in terms of I wasn't getting the good gigs like I used to. I was getting, you know, because a lot of people didn't want to be bothered with people that was on heroin at that particular time. Although a lot of people was on heroin, you know, but so I went to rehab. I went to Tombs in New York. I got busted for some heroin on 118th Street, and I went down. I got arrested. They put me in jail for possession. Stayed there about 7 days. The tomb was designed by a Chinese lady, and it was like a labyrinth. It was full of it was really the city jail, the county jail, and it was full of tunnels, you know. And they put dope fiends down there, and they'd be thrown up, and it would really smell the place. Everybody's sick, so I stayed down there. My fiance got me out. Eventually, I would go back to work with somebody playing a gig in New Jersey, New York, or in a particular area. And I would try to go to a hospital to detox. And every time I go check myself in the hospital for 3 weeks, as soon as I would come out, I'd go right to the dope man up in Harlem. So finally, I left New York after 4 years of that circus, came back to Detroit. As soon as I got in Detroit, they wanted me to teach and do some recording. My people, my parents, I'm still a kid, really. Yeah. And actually, I'm 20, 25, 26, but they thought of me as a kid, you know. They were going to put me in jail if I didn't do something about my drug habit. So discovered, did some research on an organization called Synanine. And I was in California. So I took a plane out there, California, and joined this organization. And that's where I met Esther Phillips and Art Pepper and a lot of Frank Rehat, a guy who played with Diz. A lot of jazz musicians was in the program. They had musicians, they had doctors, lawyers, professional people that was suffering from addiction. It was a blessing for me because I was able to, these guys put together a cantata, and I recorded an album for Greg Dykes, and it's called The Prince of Peace, and we used a lot of union musicians out in California, featured on the album on Epic Records. It was Esther Phillips, myself, and a big choir, strings, and big band, you know, it was about 30, 40 pieces, you know. I was able to play with these guys out on the club in Santa Monica, California, out there near the ocean. And I stayed out there with this program and learned a lot. I did a lot of reading, a lot of research and whatnot. I learned about nonprofit organizations and with incorporation papers and articles of incorporation, bylaws and all that kind of stuff. And so I stayed out there about 2.5 years, and then I came back to Detroit. And immediately when I got back, I was just coming to Detroit, passing through to go back to New York. I was scared to go back, really. But got in Detroit, and all of a sudden, I got an abundance of work, like teaching and playing and recording. And I got married all of a sudden for the first time, and acquired some property. And started. I built a infrastructure here in terms of a magazine, record company, publishing company. I was called Tribe. See, Motown had left Detroit in the late 60s, early 70s. Berry Gordy went out to California to continue his career as a publisher, and he's getting he was really getting a lot of distribution from California, so he went out there to be closer to that community, you know, distribution community at that particular time was like California and New York, maybe Chicago. You know, we, this is an analog world. It's not, you know, we didn't have no internet back in those days. It's analog.
Don't you feel like that was the turning point of Motown, where the sound changed and the focus kind of changed? It was like early 70s when they left.
They left, and they started using some of the musicians from Motown, went out there with Gordy, you know, Barry Gordy. But then you had some that stayed here, you know, because it affected people like Marcus Belgrave, Phil Rallon, people that's on Tribe. They had recorded these guys, but they never did put the music out. Motown never, it was on this, they promised them. They put the music on the shelf and never did release it. Now, that's the same thing that happened to me when I was working for Atlantic Records. They recorded me. They were supposed to produce an album on me, but nothing really happened, you know. So at this particular point, at this juncture in time, this is 1970, I said, well, we can do this ourselves, because I had history with Sun Ra, and I saw how Sun Ra was producing himself, and Sun Ra had two labels. He had a publishing company, his managing company. He's self-sufficient, you know, that means he could play any kind of music you want. He could play anything, you know, because he had his own label. And he had his own audience. He was building his own audience. This was in 1960. Sun Ra came to New York in 1958, two years before I got there. And he brought all his musicians from Chicago, like John Gilmore, Pat Patrick, Ronnie Boykins, a lot of folks. It was about six or seven of them. I'm playing jazz, but I'm playing, in addition to Sun Ra, I was playing a lot of mainstream. I was playing with organ trios stuff, you know, and then I played Latin music. I was playing, but these guys I was working with was on a label, and it was like working for Chrysler or something. And you had to play a certain format. The producer wanted them to produce a certain sound and not vary from that sound, because they feeding that particular audience. And at that time, everybody had their own identity. So if an artist was really creative, they didn't want to really deal with his creativity that much. If they had a sound, they wanted you to sustain that, keep recording, and you had to be presenting things in that tunes in that same vein, so the audience would keep buying it. Guys that ventured out didn't have no record contract. If they did, it would be one or two albums. You know, they wanted the record companies wanted somebody to sell their catalog. Being homogenized, that came later on. It came in the 80s. Everything really sounded like in the 80s. But in the 60s, you had these companies like Blue Note, Riverside, Impulse, and everybody had a producing jazz, but they had their own take. They had their own take on concept. You know, if you was by Riverside, you had the Riverside sound. They were relatively small at that time, you know. So anyway, getting back to this Detroit, I came back, and these guys were really distraught in terms of not having that much work after Gordy had left, because every day they was doing sessions. So all of a sudden, they were gone. So we wanted to really put some music together, you know, and put it out. Incidentally, all these guys that I hooked up with, I had worked with on the road. Marcus Belgrave, I had worked with him with Hank Crawford and Larry Price and Marvin Gaye, you know. Phil Rallon, I met him on the road in Indianapolis, you know. Harold McKinney, he had always been in Detroit, and I had been working with him for a long time before I left going to New York, relocating in New York. So these guys had been working with major labels, and it was always on somebody's album as a side, a glorified side man, you know.
Mary had some little lambs. Their fleece was black as coal. No matter how hard they tried, they could never reach their goals. Beasts snatched them from the cradle womb and smashed them in the earth. Or they wound up in a tomb. Short life from time of birth. Traps were laid throughout the land to destroy her children and her man. War, dope, prostitution, birth control and liver portion. While they destroy all that they can, they accuse her of abortion.
Let me ask you a question. I'm kind of in your timeline. They re-released your An Evening with the Devil, the 1972 album.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, wow, that's a great album. And Mary Had an Abortion was like, it's an amazing title for our song. Roe versus Wade went down in 1973. So was this a protest or reaction song to what was going on? Or what was your...
This is a talk about women's rights.
Yeah.
You know, have you heard the tune "Mary Had an Abortion"?
Oh yeah, I was listening to it earlier this week. This whole album, and even with the devil, is fantastic.
It's crazy. Well, that's the kind of aggressiveness I had back in the '60s. Uh-huh. You know, I was off the hook. You know, especially being off of drugs, I was like raw, you know what I mean? So I was trying to really create a different concept. Plus, I'm producing myself.
Yeah.
So no one was telling me what to do. You know, I didn't have Atlantic looking over my shoulders and trying to edit my stuff, you know what I mean? So I just, and all of us was like this. I'm just talking about me, but everybody that was a part of the tribe was managing and really investing in their music, in their career. Mary Had an Abortion is like, it was accusing Mary of having an abortion, and then they doing all they can to kill folks in Vietnam and all over the world. Uh-huh. You know, a lot of times women have an abortion for medical reasons, you know what I mean? It's a lot of different reasons why a woman would have an abortion. Plus, that's her body.
Yeah.
You know, that was just a protest on in the concept saying, well, a woman has the right to do what with her body, what that she chooses to, you know, she has that autonomy over her body. It's hers. And then on the other side, we got The Angry Young Man. Did you hear that?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's a spinoff on the police brutality. Same thing. We're going through the same thing today.
Yeah, things haven't changed.
That never changes. Never, never, never changes. We're doing the same the same issues, what I'm saying. It's the same issue. I recorded that stuff in 1970, and this is like 2021. We still deal with the same issues.
Yeah. Yeah. It's mm-hmm. weird. No one takes accountable for, like, I always look at it as a band-aid. Nothing's get healed. Everything just gets ripped off over and over.
Politics. Yeah. Politics. A bunch of tricks. Uh-huh. You know. So in that particular time too, what motivated us too, Nixon was in office. Like Trump is like Nixon on steroids. Donald Trump, he's like Nixon on steroids. But I have experienced that kind of attitude in the early 70s with Nixon and people coming back from war, all strung out on drugs and never could win the war over there. You know, they finally came because the folks wasn't giving up in Vietnam. You know, they didn't give up. It's almost like the American Indians here, you know, indigenous people. It's hard to go into somebody else's land and take over and colonize, especially indigenous people like Vietnamese and Viet Cong. You know they have a hell of a thing about, they have a hell of an identity about who they are, you know.
I'm gonna jump you up a little too. Like, you got your bachelor's and your master's just in with the last 10 years.
Yeah, well, you know what happened? I'll tell you what happened. I was working in Europe and they had their recession. The recession, the economy slowed down way down in 2008.
Yeah, I remember, you know, that.
they had their recession before we had ours, yeah, in the States. So my gigs got canceled and stuff. And I said, well, damn, let me go try to go back to school and see if I can get a degree. And because the people was giving me opportunity, I could get little grants and scholarships and whatnot to get me into the school so I can finish up. And then I got a bachelor's in organizational management, you know, because I was always interested in organizations and nonprofits and stuff like that.
Yeah, you've been doing it.
Yeah, been interested. So I got a degree in it, you know, and then I was always interested in communication, you know, like I used to produce a radio broadcast and I published a magazine. So I went and got a degree. My master's is in mass communication, radio, public publishing, research, writing is the emphasis, concentration. That was my concentration. And with that, I published a book. My dissertation was about a book I wrote, which is marketing and promotion for the 21st century musician. And it talks about copyright law and a lot of information on how to create a product, a legal product. Talks about setting up studios, websites. Talks about website constructing, because everything now is based around, ironically, it's based around websites today. It wasn't like that in the 50s and 60s. We wasn't online back in those days.
There was no such thing like this.
No.
You've been in Detroit, I guess, since the early 70s. You watched it decline. Do you feel like it's coming back?
Early 70s?
Yeah.
You feel like you're on a yo-yo. It's up and down, up and down.
Yeah. You know, I love Detroit, and then I love it for the people because, you know, in Baltimore, we're all in it together. There's no weird class structure where the guy that's in front of me is maybe has more money in his pocket, but he's going through the exact same thing I'm doing. So yeah, he can turn around and talk to me. I can talk to him. And that's Detroit also.
Yeah.
Everyone's in it. We're all in it together.
We have more communication because we're in each other's face more now.
That's right. Yeah. The
I'm talking about it used to be suburbs or in rural areas and versus urban areas, you know, everybody is coming in contact with it's not as isolated as it was in the 40s and 50s.
Yeah.
You know, even the bears is like the wild animals, bears and deers is coming into the city.
There was a time that Detroit was in the top 10. I think it had like almost 2 million people.
It was the top five. Five.
And now it's right around the same as
21st,
Baltimore,
21st.
Yeah, Baltimore's 24. So you're at like 700,000. So you got a lot of green space there available and some houses.
This gentrification is changing that thing though, you know.
Yeah, well, people,
you know, a lot of people are moving into the city. They're tearing down and building a lot of new homes and businesses in the city. Now the thing is with some of these places, minorities don't have the control over their property. So a lot of these corporations is coming in and just really taking control.
They're taking streets, like just ripping. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
In my neighborhood, I'm in the metropolitan neighborhood, and all around, this used to be a ghetto. you know. You know, it was quality in the 30s and 40s. It was like high-end neighborhood, you know.
Yeah,
nothing but Jews and professional people. Then it went down, you know. Then you nothing but prostitutes and drug dealers, you know, and gangs. Now it's up. It's with the gentrification recently. It's like they tearing down these homes and building up new homes and whatnot. People got jobs.
Babies and strollers being walked up and down the street.
3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. White ladies with strollers.
That's when you know the town has changed. Someone said gentrification is not a Starbucks. It's a white lady with a stroller walking up and down the street.
And a dog. At 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah. I know that.
But they wouldn't dare come out at 3 o'clock in the morning 20 years ago. Everything changes, you know, and
it's good that you can see that, like, you know, you that things have turned around or starting to turn around. I always look at it like your album's very optimistic. You have an education background. We're going to get into this album a little. I really think that I barely even scratched the surface of your stories. I really feel, you know, while we're in this COVID stage and you're not really able to go out and perform, maybe you might want to start knocking down these stories, because
I should.
You really, like, we just talked for 45 minutes and we haven't got anywhere. You're I bumped you from 72 to the present, and you know, we didn't even get into the early stuff or even the Sun. Like, I wanted to ask you questions about Sun Ra, but
I need somebody to sit down with me. I need a professional writer to sit down, and a writer that knows the wherewithal, the resources to get the book out. See, now it's not about writing the book; it's having the resources to get it out in the marketplace. It's just like recording. We weren't just sitting up there recording. We did research on how we was going to market. Every time we would do a recording, we'd do some research, figure out how it's going to be sold and marketed. You know, even before we play the note.
If you're starting to do your stories, right, and document, I don't know, like 24 or 25 hours worth of stories, you can almost do like a greatest hits and send them around and say, these are the type of stories that I'm talking about, and I want funding. So,
you talk about? Do some
record your stories.
MP tracks, huh?
Yeah. Also, you know, do it like on a Zoom maybe, and you got your
do a video.
Yeah, you got your book on tape already. You know, just by your stories. You know, you can turn around and do like a greatest hits of maybe 20 minutes and say, these are the type of stories I'm talking about. I want some
like a podcast.
Yeah, well, you do that too. Yeah.
You talk about document these stories, and then maybe at some point you accumulate them.
Yeah.
And come out with a
shop like a greatest hits and say, these are the topics that I'm talking about. This is my story. I need some funding. It's tough. I mean, with money, you can do anything. Money's the thing, unfortunately.
But it has to be promoted. It has to be promoted in a certain way to motivate people to buy it, you know?
Sure. Yeah.
You know, just like that marketing and promoting for the 21st musician. It started out being a biography on me.
Yeah.
I said, well, wait a minute. Maybe I'll just do something that the people, that the musician would need.
Evening with stars, you are the moon who guided me. Morning light, I found you. From the sea, you whisper love, feeling the wind, my soul flies, singing your name brings me joy. Zera, ah, Zera, Zera, amor. Guarda di simpatia.
All right, we're getting into this album. We're gonna talk all day.
Oh yeah.
But I'm loving it. Okay, so the album is the Wendell Harrison Tribe. It's Get Off Your Knees. The album came out January 8th on 2021. What we're talking about on this album is nothing but optimism. You have where it's funny, like you're almost okay. You're 78. People kind of stretch for ideas of things to say. You have so many ideas in here, crammed in here. It's real obvious that you have a viewpoint. You have ideas that you want to talk about.
The album is kind of like an eclectic of different. It's jazz, but you got I got people on there from Senegal.
Yeah,
you know, dealing with some West African vibes. Senegal and Guinea-Bissau, which is Portuguese base, and Wolof. You know, that's a native language for Senegal. Actually, they got 12 languages in Senegal, 12 local languages. And I got a Pate. He's from Senegal. He plays bass and he sings.
Yeah, you have him on the album. You have him on a couple tracks.
On a couple tracks. And he plays bebop too. I had a guy, he learned bebop from a guy that grew up with us. Sam Saunders. He moved to Senegal and started teaching jazz, and Pate was one of his students. So Pate learned a lot about Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie and Bud Pop. So he doesn't work much playing the bebop stuff. He works playing popular tunes from West Africa.
The educators of the world's children. We are the educators of the children of this world. We are the educators, the liberators, proactivators, the molders and sculptors of human minds, the catalysts for budding plant children. We nourish the children of the world with seeds of greatness to take root, sprout, grow, and blossom into the unseen hopes, promises, and aspirations of tomorrow's yet unborn. We are the sowers.
You know, then I have people from the Shrine of Black Madonna in Bayo Chui reciting poetry by education. I did some African drums on, and I played bass clarinet and clarinet on that. Being inspired, learning, earning and learning. He's a great poet.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to swipe in, log on, and sign off. You will not be able to lose yourself on hemp and opioids, Uber out for pizza and beer during commercials, because the fourth revolution will not be advertised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Amazon in four parts with direct access to Prime Video. The fourth revolution will not show you pictures of Trump blowing a bugle and leading a charge by Mike Pence, John Kelly, and John Bolton to eat corned beef confiscated from a Bronx sanctuary. The fourth revolution will not be advertised. The fourth revolution will be brought to you by the Fake News Awards, but will not star Julia Roberts and Robert Downey Jr. or Bart Simpson and Ellen. The fourth revolution will not give you thousands of likes.
And then he's got a spin on revolution.
Yeah, the revolution will not be televised is now revolution.
Yeah. He got a spin, but he updated it, dealing with Trump and the clowns we dealing with today, you know?
with this educator thing I wrote, oh, this must be a tribute to Betsy DeVos. Yeah.
She. Yeah, that's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. You know, it's like it's a thought provoking. You know, make you think. You know.
You were talking about Pate, and this is the Save the Children, very similar to Educator. It has the same kind of vibe or message, and that's a beautiful song.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. He's,
how do you pronounce that?
The simile.
That's it, simile kale.
Yeah, yeah, that's it. Yes, simile. Okay. That's one of them. The other one is Sierra.
Yeah, he's on Sierra.
That's title six. That's track six.
Prayer is good. God, I have to send to meet your needs. If you're in good health, you can help yourself. Why you can't? It's been proven true. You can do it too. Wake up. It's not in vain. If your future isn't bright, then you only have yourself to blame. There's opportunity now to better your dreams. No one's better than you.
And the get off your knees is
now that was done. Now, you know, I wrote that in 1968.
Really?
When I just got out of rehab, believe it or not. You know,
with the lyrics included?
Yeah, I wrote the lyrics, yeah, first. Uh-huh. It was a play, you know. And a guy would always see himself as a victim, you know, and people would be telling him something. And he had everything in front of him to do better, you know, but he's always complacent. You know, yeah. He never would do anything. He wants somebody to come and give him everything. And so I'm saying, get up off your knees. I'll agree. Prayer is good, but you got to hustle some to meet your needs.
Yeah.
If you're in good health, you'll help yourself while you can. Do it soon, you know. And then it says, wake up. It's not in vain, you know. So I recorded that with a lady that recorded with me in the 80s. Her name is Mickey Braden. She's great. We kind of remind you of Betty Carter back in the day. I wrote this like for a second, like a Betty Carter. Mickey recorded it, and she did a great job.
Yeah, she has like a blues vibe to her too. Like
Well, she does this Ma Rainey play, and she got a Bessie Smith play that she does all over the world. You know,
that'll do it.
She stays in New Jersey. She's from Detroit, but she stays in Montclair, New Jersey. So I got her singing the lyrics, and I got Pate doing a chant in Portuguese. It's Creole Portuguese, though. You know, I wrote it in 3/4, but we ended up doing a 5/4 time, odd meter time.
My favorite song on this album is First Love.
Oh, yeah. First Love is it starts out with a melancholy, cerebral, like an imagery. It's when you first meet a young lady that's really interested and interesting to you. You're talking and everything is just as calm and it's pretty romantic. But once you get into the relationship, it can be kind of rocky, you know? And raunchy and stuff like that, you know. I'm reflecting on my childhood when I was like 15, 16 years old. I was meeting young ladies. They didn't know who they were. And I didn't know who I was or what I wanted. You know, it was my way or the highway, or she says her way, and it had to be like that, you know.
Yeah, it's weird how, like, I always wish that, you know, they send these kids home from school, like these kids at 12 o'clock, you know, and it's a half a day or something.
Yeah.
Like, it'd be great if they kept them in there and explained about relationships. Because when you're young, you're play acting. You think this is how you're supposed to act.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And you don't know how to deal with conflict, and you don't realize that, you know, it's about listening and sharing and being supportive. It's
communication.
Yeah, it takes a lot. I always say, don't get married until you're 30, because you don't know who you are until you're 30.
Yeah. So that tune, if you listen to that tune, we start out with this meeting and talking and everything is really harmonic. And then when we start dealing with the relationship, it changes feeling and changes the meter, goes into 7/4 time, 7/8 time. You know, and that's where the negotiation comes in. We're negotiating with one another. Musically, we're negotiating with the beat, you know, and trying to make this beat smooth. 7/8 time is really a rough meter, you know. It's not like 4/4 time. When you negotiate these melodies and improvisation, the job is really making it digestible and understandable to the listener. And that takes pretty, it takes experience to do that, you know.
I'm going to have to listen to this whole song all over again. Yeah. I'm just digging it. I just want to do what we basically almost talked about the whole album, but yeah. I want to talk about Saga of a Carrot, because
Saga of a Carrot is when I was a vegetarian.
Okay. So what a great, what a great name for a song. What's the thought on that song?
When I was in New York, I was staying in the loft down there on 89 East Broadway. And every morning we'd get up and make a salad, you know, practice and meditate. You know, it was in the Eastern philosophy and stuff like that, you know. And about 6 o'clock, we started drinking this wine. And by 9, 10 o'clock, we would be drunk, you know what I mean? And the music reflects that. It's a breakdown in the music that everybody's, it's like an avant-garde thing inside this Saga of the Carrot. The next day we do it all over again. We starting up fresh, get up, take a shower, start washing lettuce and cabbage off, and dealing with wheat germ and brewer's yeast, and we might make some bread on Tuesdays. Went to Tuesdays and Thursdays, make bread, whatnot. And people come up by and be reciting poetry. You know, this is like the hippie community of the 60s.
Yeah.
And then we might start taking a sip of wine, little in the evening. And a little herb, you know, and we'd be off the hook. People get drunk and want to fight.
It's weird how that works, right? That inner urge of anger comes out with alcohol.
Yeah.
It's unexpected.
Especially when you're young, you know.
Oh, yeah.
How old are you now?
I'm 55.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I stopped drinking about 5 years ago. It was the best thing I could do for myself.
Yeah, you're clear now.
Yeah, I felt.
When's your birthday?
I'm a Virgo, September 11th.
Oh man.
Yeah. So you know how we are. We like to be organized and we're bossy and
you work a lot.
Always. I have multiple jobs.
Yeah, that's your forte. You know, you work. That's who you are.
Yeah,
that's
If I sit and watch TV, I feel like I'm wasting my life.
Yeah.
And I'd rather keep on working and moving. And it's funny. I was thinking about you're doing the salad stuff and you're living a healthy life, but it really didn't fully click in. And you went to heroin. What would your life have been if you like stayed that way, you know, and would have been able to.
Experiences is my game.
You definitely had them.
You know, I'm curious. I'm kind of a curious guy, especially back in those years. You know, I was always curious about the music.
Your early stuff does have like a big Sun Ra influence. And I just had one question about them is in my mind, I would think that group is chaotic. Like there's too many visionaries, too many amazing artists all kind of working together, but.
No, Sun Ra dominated though.
So he was able to keep everyone in check. And
yeah, it was his thing. It was his thing. He let you know, he had the reins of the whole thing. It was his show. Now, if you want to be a part of it, and he would say, if you're a part of it, you're going to be famous. Just playing with me is going to make you famous.
Yeah.
Because people are going to come looking for you. And that's what happened to me. I played with him and I started getting all kinds of gigs doing other things.
Yeah. Well, I always look at Sun Ra is the George Clinton of funk.
Yeah.
You know, you play with George Clinton, you got a pedigree. Same with Sun Ra. You work with Sun Ra and you got that stamp of approval. You know, that runs the rest of your life.
Speaking of George Clinton, I did a couple of recordings for him in the 70s. And I worked with Proof, which is a rapper. I worked also with Carl Craig. So I did a lot of commercial stuff. Uh-huh. See, in other words, I'm a jazz artist, but I'm always recording other forms of music. Just like I just did a streaming with a Bosnian group, Slavic community in the east there, you know, just near Russia, just near Moscow. They was in Detroit, and they wanted a clarinet player. So I've been doing a lot of that music, odd meter music with them, and then I do a lot with Middle Eastern folks. We got one of the largest Arab communities in America. So I hit with them a lot, you know. I do a lot of African and West African and East African music, as well as Spanish, Latin. So I'm kind of like an eclectic guy. You know, I'm a Libra, born October the 1st, yeah. But I have a lot of Gemini in me, too.
Libra, fair and balanced, sees everything in all viewpoints. Kind of considerate. When I say something nasty, you'll come back with something a little more appropriate.
Try to.
What was it with the Gemini?
Yeah, I got a Gemini Saturn and Uranus.
So the Gemini is your travel. So that's the wanderlust in you. Like and your Gemini is that dual body. So while you have that connection to Earth and the soul and spirit, that other body is that little devil running around tempting you, looking for fun.
Yeah. He's bored to death.
Yeah, that other body knows that there's so much in this world to experience. The same old, it's boring.
It's balancing. You learn how to balance it, and you learn how to stay out of trouble. You know, the old you get, you know.
Wendell Harrison, I be honest with you, these interviews go about 20 minutes. We play about 3-4 songs. I don't know how I'm going to get this whole in here. We talked for an hour. It was good.
That's cool.
Yeah.
What a difference a day makes. 24 little hours. From the sun and the flowers. Where there used to be rain. My yesterday was blue, dear.
Can I ask you one question before we hang up? I love Esther Phillips. When I was a little kid, she did that disco song, What a Difference a Day Makes. And I never heard of her before. And she, to me, was like an old lady. I was like a little kid, right? So then I went into little Esther Phillips and I was like, I love this woman. She has such a great like range and experience. And I believe everything she says.
Very soulful.
Yeah.
Very soulful.
What was she like as a person? I don't hear too many people talking about her.
Well, she was big, but in the 60s, she was big. 50s and 60s, she was big, real big. You know, then the drugs just took her. She couldn't stay out of the drug life, you know?
Yeah, I think she went back.
She went back. When she left Synanon, she went back to drugs. I saw her on the road. She came to Detroit. I saw her at a club in Detroit, and I went and spoke to her because I had gotten back in. I had left Synanon, and I looked at her. I said, "Wow, she was she had gotten high. She wasn't really herself, but she recognized me. You know, I noticed she had got back, and then shortly after that, she had died. She passed away.
Yeah, it's a shame." Yeah, she had a talent. It's one of those things that, you know, her hits were young, and so they don't get on that oldies radio station. So people don't realize what a catalog she had. Like, she's someone that people might forget about in the future. I'm gonna put them in a letter and drop them in the mail. I'm gonna send them to a woman a friend of mine told me about. She's a gumbo cooker and an alligator hooker. Make a dead man jump and shout.
Evening with stars, you're the moon who guided me. Morning light.
All right, Thomas.
Yes,
yeah,
it was
this
fun.
Is gonna be cool.
Thank you for talking to me today on Something Came from Baltimore.
Okay, glad that we had a great conversation.
We sure did.
The connection was great.
My soul flies, singing your name brings me joy.